So we're going to start there. We aren't going to read the whole thing, but I would really encourage you this week, read through Genesis 1 and 2, really, but read through Genesis 1 and just remember this incredible account of God creating everything. But as you're turning there, I'm just going to assume page 1 is going to be a little bit easier to find than most pages that we tend to flip to. But right at the beginning of Scripture, the first few words of Scripture say, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That's kind of a hard pill for some people to swallow. Because for a lot of people, their beginning begins a different way. They don't want to say, "In the beginning, God created." The fact is that their name is not in the creation account. And so many people think that the world should revolve around them. Just look at some of the celebrities and some of the ridiculous things that they say. You actually might believe some of them literally believe they are the center of the universe. Like they can't understand the world functioning without them. And you see that type of an ego, but somewhere in a lot of us, that's almost kind of built in. We may not say it out loud, but a lot of people have this same mentality that even though we know the Bible doesn't say it, in our own world and universe, we think the world began with "in the beginning, Mark," or "in the beginning, Steve," or whoever. I don't know Steve. Well, I do know Steve, but I'm not mentioning him. But we have this. But the thing is, Scripture begins with these words, and it's your first fill-in. "In the beginning, God." That's how it begins. That's how everything begins. And these are some of the most important words for us as believers. Found in Scripture, these are some of the most foundational words that we need to remember. In the beginning, God. Why is it so important? Because if this isn't where your beginning is, if you think it's something different, then your whole view of the world is going to be warped. We wonder why it is so acceptable for people to celebrate and participate in immoral acts. It's because a lot of them are beginning someplace else than God. And when we do that, we look at the view and it gets tweaked just enough where immoral acts seem moral and moral acts seem immoral. If we don't begin here within the beginning God, we're going to have a twisted view of the world and it's not going to look like how it should. We have to begin with God. And when we come to the first few words of Scripture here, we truly get an answer to one of life's greatest questions, one of the most asked questions. Where did it all come from? Where did life begin? And I was listening to this Christian comedian named Ron Pearson. I got a picture of him up there. Who, if you have Netflix, look up the Apostles of Comedy, because he's on there with three other Christian comedians. It's just a great show. And it's completely clean. You can watch it for all ages, and it's great. But Ron Pearson asked this question, and he wanted to go look for this type of question. And he found that in school, they kind of told him, "We can give you the answer to that. We know where life began." And he said, especially in the hard sciences, the three hard sciences. Anyone know what the three hard sciences are? We start with biology. What did I hear? I heard another one. Chemistry is over here. No, chemistry is the middle one. Sorry. So biology, chemistry, and then physics. Physics. So we have the three hard sciences there. That's what the three dots on your sheet are there. So you may not be a good drawer, because I certainly am not. So we'll see how this goes. But he started there, and he wanted to look, and he asked each of these ones, where did life begin? So he went to chemistry first, and chemists say that life began with an atom. It began with an atom, and does anyone know what goes around an atom? Molecules, neutrons, specifically, neutrons. So you have neutrons that go around an atom there, and he wanted to know, well, where did an atom come from? And he found out that an atom's size is 10 to the minus 10, which is really, really small. I'm not a great math person, but I'm just guessing that's really small. That's microscopic. And he asked, well, where did something like that come from, something that small? And so he found out that if you take that and you go down to 10 to the minus 33, an atom becomes so small it actually implodes on itself and becomes a black hole and just ceases to exist. And they had no answer for that. They can't say where it came from, and they can't explain how this happened. So he decided to go over to the physicist. And the physicist says that life begins at a single point, something they call singularity, where at the Big Bang, you had the universe kind of explode out. And as I'm drawing these, you can kind of copy it on your paper, once again, as best as you can, because clearly I can draw a perfect circle. So so the universe exploded out. And what we do know is that the universe is continuing to move out, and it's slowing down as it's moving out. So you have that explosion there. But there's one thing that they can't answer, and he actually talked to some of the top physicists at Caltech over in Los Angeles, and they said, there's one thing that we don't know. We don't know what happened in the first 3 minutes here. From 3 minutes on, we can tell you what happened there. But for those first 3 minutes, we just don't have an answer. We don't know what happened there. So he went over to the biologist. And the biologist said that life begins at a single cell. And after 2 billion years, in their viewpoint, they say that single cell evolved into a two-cell structure. And it evolved into this two-cell structure. And then this crazy thing happened that they can't explain. 2 billion years to move from one to two cells. Then, in just 5 million years, suddenly that two-cell structure became all 36 body types that we currently have in existence. In just 5 million years, from 2 billion to 5 million. So the thing they can't answer, it's called the Cambrian explosion, population explosion. Cambrian population explosion. 5 million, it was supposed to take 2 billion years. And from their best guess, it became in just 5 million years. And after that, all of a sudden, we now get to where we have man. Now, what are they leaving out? In the beginning, God. See, Ron Pearson did this great thing. I thought it was so creative, so don't think I made that up on my own. But in the beginning, God. See, so many of us and so many people in our world want to look everywhere else for where the beginning is. So if you don't remember anything else from this morning, remember these four words. In the beginning, God. It's not any sort of science. We didn't create ourselves. And we'd be surprised by how many questions in life those four words can answer for us. I'd imagine coming to a passage like this, we probably have a number of questions come to mind, ranging from general to more specific. How did it all work out? And everyone has opinions on how life began and even how creation could have worked. And they kind of fall into three major viewpoints. You have the I just don't care viewpoint. You have the viewpoint that I imagine most of us fall into, that God created everything. And then you have kind of a third viewpoint, that evolution and chance, when mixed with time, gave us life as we know it now. But what's crazy is even though I disagree with evolutionists, they do give a lot of answers that sometimes make sense. And we have to give them credit for that. They have a lot of answers. But what I've found is they have a lot of answers for questions we're not really asking. Have you noticed that a lot of us want to know, well, where did it start? Where did it all begin? And they can't answer that. They can answer how we got to where we are now, but they can't give an answer for how it began. And when they try, it's kind of embarrassing. I've literally heard evolutionists claim that perhaps life began when aliens brought it here. Talk about picking up a whole new bag of worms there. Did they evolve too? And where did they come from? How did they make it here? And why would they just leave some life and then go away? Like, it doesn't make any sense. Was it those first 3 minutes that they can't explain, like a mini episode of Star Trek where they put the doctor on torpedo duty and he accidentally shot the asteroid and the Big Bang happened and they're arguing and saying, no, I said don't shoot the rock, and dang it, Jim, I'm not a doctor, not a gunsmith, and whatever it is. Thank you. Truth is, when it comes to creation, the beginning of time, we have a lot of questions. And it's okay to have questions. Sometimes we almost feel guilty about having questions when it comes to God. But you're allowed to have questions. That's actually a very healthy thing. And truth be told, I could teach probably, not me personally, but we could have an hour-long session for every day for like 6 months and still not get through everything there is to talk about when it comes to creation and evolution and where we got to where we are now. So I actually set up a little booth back there. Maybe as you walked in, you saw the books. If you want to know more, if you're interested in this idea of creation or evolution or even faith for the things happening in the beginning, then you can check out one of those books. I wrote down the titles and then a spot for your name. If you could just write your name legibly so I know I'm not going to like pester you. Just take as long as you need to read through them. But I will warn you, if you're not used to like college level reading, this might be kind of unnerving. Because some of this stuff, it's written by college professors with doctorates, right? So some of it gets a little wordy. So I'd encourage you, keep a dictionary nearby or Google open because you'll probably learn a few new words. But those are back there. If you want to know more about this subject, I obviously can't get through everything there is to know in 30 minutes. So I encourage you, go back there, check out one of those books and read through it as long as it might take. However, I do want to look at a couple of evidences of creation. I want us to at least have something, and I'd like to share with you some of these things, but keep in mind, we can never prove God created everything in the traditional sense, right? Because in the traditional mindset, you have to physically see it happen, which obviously we can't do. We can see evidences of it, though, that I think is overwhelming, and it points us to God. But I also want to say that I've heard some people say that true Christians can't believe in evolution, and I would disagree with one condition. If someone wants to believe that God was there working through evolution and guiding every single step, and it was God who was the moving force of it, then I have no theological problem with that. I disagree with it, but I'm not going to condemn you. I don't think it's a salvation issue. I think it's wrong, and I don't agree with it, but I just want to clear that up. I think you can be a Christian and still believe that. But the truth is, traditional evolution has a belief system that has no need of God, and that's the main problem with it. You don't need God with evolution in their mindset. That's why so many, like 98, 99%, almost 100% of evolutionists have no faith whatsoever. They don't believe in God because there's no need of Him. You just give something enough time and good luck, and it will eventually evolve into us. And that's the belief. But I'd like us to at least look at some of the proofs or evidences of creation. So the first one I want us to look at is called bacterial flagellum and the theory of irreducible complexity. So go ahead and pull out your dictionaries and bacterial flagellum and the theory of irreducible complexity. If some of those words seem big, just keep in mind it's coming from me and not a doctorate, a college professor. But I actually have this book in the back that this theory really took some footing from. It's been proposed from way back in the 1800s. But Dr. Michael Behe, in his book Darwin's Black Box, which I have back there if you're curious about it, proposes this theory of irreducible complexity, which I found a definition online that is mostly understandable. So once again, pull out your dictionaries here. But an irreducibly complex system is one that requires several interlacing parts to be present at the same time, where the removal of one or more of those parts causes the whole system to malfunction. Okay, we got it. Now I understand what irreducible complexity is. I think he summarized it quite well with that last sentence. In other words, destroy one part and the whole system fails and falls apart. That's the idea here. Evolution tells us that everything evolved one piece at a time, but what about systems that we have right now, things that we have right now, where if you remove one part, it just doesn't work anymore? So you come to this thing called the bacterial flagellum. And it looks something like this. And you have it on your sheet there, too, so if you can't see it very well up there. But bacterial flagellum is basically the world's smallest and most energy-efficient motor. It's this incredible thing. If you were to take a bacteria and just zone in on one small part of it, you would see this flagellum on the end. And it's this little motor. It's fast. It can spin its tail there, the actual flagellum part, 17,000 rounds per minute, up to that. It ranges from about 4,000 up to 17,000. But that's a really fast engine, right? This thing, and what's crazy is it only uses 2% of the bacteria's energy. I mean, that's like driving somewhere and only 2% of your gas is actually used on the engine, right? That's amazing how this thing works. But it's, so you look at that, you look at all these parts that are a part of it. I don't want to read all of them, but you look at that and you can really compare it to like the engines that we've created. And if you look at that, you also see that its fuel is up to 40 different proteins that it needs there in order to run properly. Now you look at a system like that and tell me what it doesn't need. Right? Remember the question, which came first, the chicken or the egg? Right? Well, what came first? Did it have the flagellum first? Okay, what was spinning it? Okay, well, maybe it was missing the rotor part. Well, once again, what was spinning this motor? See, the thing is, if you look at this and you took out just one part from there, it would cease to work, even if it didn't have the right protein mix, and maybe it didn't have all the proteins it needed. It wouldn't work. You cannot reduce its complexity. That makes sense? That's where the theory of irreducible complexity comes by. But I also want to go over one more thing. And I know maybe some of you are sitting there like, gee, I wish I knew it was going to be a biology lesson this morning. I would be watching the playoffs right now. But just try to stay with me because I have one more example that I think is really neat. And this is one of my favorites. So I want you all to meet Pete the Giraffe. I named him Pete because I could. I typed in Pete the Giraffe on Google, and that was the first one that popped up. So maybe his name's actually Pete. I don't know. But giraffes are amazing creatures that just don't make any sense to evolutionists. They say that giraffes evolved their long necks by trying to reach the higher leaves and fruit up on trees and also to help survive floods and whatnot, which is why I'm somewhat convinced that eventually humans will evolve into this like 90 degree angle so that we can read our phones a little easier. But what's crazy is that they don't actually have fossil proof showing this progression. Kind of like you'll see one back there, a book called Icons of Evolution, where you see the normal like walking man where he's getting progressively taller. They only have two fossils from that whole thing. Literally, that's a picture some guy drew just to assume the progression. But anyway, that book is really great looking at some of the things there. But so one of the there's a lot of interesting biological things with the giraffe that are just neat. Like, for instance, it was created with this massive heart, this giant heart that's in its neck. Because remember how gravity works, right? It wants to pull everything down. So imagine that long neck trying to get blood up to its head. It had to have this massive heart there that could actually create that type of pressure and get the blood up there so that it would survive. But the problem is, what happens when that blood starts coming back down, right? That's really fast. You know, keep that same blood pressure up, and what happens is the jugular vein actually contracts and restricts the blood flow as it comes back down. That way its heart doesn't just, you know, burst. And that's in there. And I wonder, well, at what point in its evolutionary process did it think that, hey, maybe we should probably have this contracting thing so we don't keep having heart attacks all the time? But even beyond that, it has this other problem that you think of all the pressure, right, sending blood up to its brain. Now imagine when it goes down to take a drink of water. Have you ever had a head rush from, like, having your head upside down for so long? You can feel the pressure building up, right? So this giraffe, when it bends down, there's some blood pressure problems that can happen because all that pressure that was pushing blood up against gravity now has gravity on its side and it's pumping just as hard into its head, right? That can cause some issues. Imagine if you had a wheelbarrow full of dirt and you were pushing it up a hill, all that pressure, all that energy, all that problem, and then you got to the top and all of a sudden it just is a downfall. If you applied the same amount of pressure and same amount of energy trying to go down the hill as you did up the hill, you would have a crash, right? You would have problems. And that's the same problem this giraffe would have. Every time it would bend down, if it didn't have this system in place, its head would just not be there anymore. So God designed a giraffe with this incredible thing where it has these arteries that supply blood flow up to the head that they restrict, just like it does on the way down, and they divert the blood into a web of small blood vessels near the top of the head. Basically, think of it like a giant sponge. Not because there's actually a sponge in its head, but it works like a sponge. It absorbs the blood pressure. So that way, every time the giraffe goes down for a drink of water, its head doesn't just blow up as it might do. And this is really crazy. Like, how could it have evolved into this? At one point in its evolutionary stage, how many giraffes had to die because they were thirsty? And how many of these poor young giraffes had to watch their parents keel over every time they barely thought of water before their biology caught up and said, maybe we should create a sponge? It's amazing how God made this, and it doesn't make sense. How could that have evolved? And that's not how life works. I don't believe we were some cosmic accident that happened by chance. Personally, I believe God created everything in 7 literal days, among other reasons, because I know that He can. He doesn't need evolution. He may have, because I know He's creative, and that's quite the creative process, but I know that God could create everything in 7 literal days. He could have created it like that. That's one of the main reasons I believe that to be. And as I mentioned, I encourage you to take time this week and read through the creation story. And I just want to recap it for us here, because God started by creating the heavens and the earth, right? That's right when we started. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was formless. So on day one, God created light, and He created night and day. And then that happened. He said it was good. So the second day came, and God separates the waters, and He creates sky. On the third day, God creates land, seas, and vegetation, which is like food, right? So day 3 is kind of one of my personal favorite days of creation. He created food on that third day. The fourth day comes along. I know that might surprise some of you, but the fourth day comes along, and God creates the stars, including our sun and our moon. Next, on day 5, God creates life in the oceans and in the air and tells them to be fruitful and multiply. Day 6, God creates animals for the land, including creating us, mankind. And you've probably heard this before, but I want to make sure we see it here again. And it's found in, and these are going to be in your notes. But I want us to read verses 27 and verse 31. Of Genesis 1. This is day 6. He says, so God created mankind in His own image. In the image of God, He created them. Male and female, He created them. Then down to verse 31. God saw all that He had made, and it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the 6th day. Did you know that out of everything God created, everything that He could have put His own touch on, the only thing He created in His image was us? He could have formed one of the animals into His own image. He could have formed a dog in His own image. He could have formed any plant into His own image, but He chose us. He chose you. You were created in the image of God. That's something Satan tries to take away from us. Doesn't he? When he tries to drag us through the mud, he tries to make you think like you are worthless. All he's trying to do is take this truth away from you. And he tries to tell you, you're not created in the image of God. Not someone like you. But Scripture is true. If you think about it, we are God's crowning achievement in creation. Nothing compared to us. You can go out to the most beautiful plateaus on earth. You can climb the tallest mountains and look at the landscape and be in awe at all you can see. At night, you can look up to the stars and see all that God created, even beyond our own earth, and just be amazed at His creativity and His artistry. But as you do that, I want you to remember that nothing compares to you and me. Nothing makes Him as proud as creating us. If you look back at the creation story, you'll notice that every single day He ends it by looking at what He created and said, it is good. But as we just read, when He finished with us and He saw us alongside all of His creation, He said, it is very good. It wasn't until He created us that He saw it complete and saw it as very good. And there may be one last question you might have, like, where was Jesus in all of this? Being Christians, we know that Jesus was there. But how? I didn't see his name. Well, if you look at Colossians 1 that I have up on there on the screen for you, you see him say, "For in him, Jesus, all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him, all things hold together." So clearly, Paul tells us in Colossians, Jesus was there. In fact, he was the driving force of it. But how does that work? I didn't see Jesus' name in Genesis 1. I want to see Jesus' name in Genesis 1. We'll flip over to John 1:1. I'll have it up on the screen for you. It's your next fill in there. But John 1:1, and even verse 2, sorry. Anyway, but first two verses of John start, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." And then notice this. He was with God in the beginning. In the beginning was God. In the beginning, God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. How is Jesus titled in John 1:1? As the Word. How did God bring creation to be? He spoke it. His very Word brought life. Jesus is the Word. The name Jesus may not have been there, but he was there in Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God. The one thing that keeps getting left out as we try to study the beginning, the one thing that they don't have an answer for. In the beginning, God. And I wish I had more time to go over other proofs of creation, like how Noah and the Great Flood can explain carbon dating, and how it's clear that God created the earth with age, which would answer some more questions for us, or how some of the fossils we have are just wildly misunderstood. And Lynn Lund actually gave me a DVD on this, on the subject matter, so you can talk to him about it, because he loves that DVD there. But so don't think this is it. Don't think that I was here to just try to prove, if you believe in evolution, I'm not expecting you to leave and saying, "Man, he brought up some great points. My whole life has changed. I now completely agree with him." I wish that's how life worked. But if nothing else, I want us to leave here thinking. I want us to leave here wondering, do I actually believe in the beginning God created, or do I believe something else? And maybe the problems that I've faced in life are coming up because my viewpoint has been askewed. Because I've been looking at this world through the wrong lens. That passage that we read in Colossians 1. It's amazing the verses that Paul uses to lead up to those verses there. Colossians 1, 13 and 14. He says, "For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins." If you haven't accepted Christ yet, I want you to look at this verse and know that it's not just a verse for other people. This is a truth to humanity. This is a truth to you. This is a truth to me, thankfully. God loved us so much that not only did he create us, but when he saw that we had taken our lives and put them into the dominion of darkness, he went as far as he could reach to bring us back. He wants us with him, and he wants you. He knows he has a future for you, one that's not plagued with guilt and shame, but with a future, one that's filled with freedom and joy. And so if you haven't accepted him, I invite you, as we sing these last few songs, to come forward and ask what it means to become a Christian. You don't have to agree with everything yet. But I want to make sure you know this incredible life that God has prepared for us. And for us as a church, may we never believe that we are the ones who created all things. May we never try to trust in just our own power, but remember the God that we serve is the one that created everything that we look at. We're not trying to reach this world for him alone. We have this incredible powerful God on our side, and He guides you every step of the way. You don't have to fear. I've heard that it's been said, that it says in Scripture 365 times, do not fear. I think it's something we can believe in. I think if God felt it important enough to repeat that enough times, it meant that we might need reminders. So remember our powerful God. Remember that in the beginning, God created. Let us stand and sing.